Here we are. Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas, originally written by Hugh Martin and Ralph Blane in 1943, 80 years ago, for the 1944 movie Meet Me in St. Louis, to be sung by the incomparable Judy Garland. Is one of the most sung, recorded, and played Christmas songs of the entire 20th century. But why? What is it about this beautiful, hopeful, and somewhat sad melody and lyric that seems to capture the holiday spirit so well? How does this wonderfully simple tune pull at our heartstrings so effectively? Is it just because it was Judy Garland, or because of the other greats who sang it, like Sinatra? Is it because it was written and recorded and first sung during World War II? Or is there something else at work here? And why are there so many different versions of the lyrics, gosh darn it? Let's dive in and find out. So, welcome back to a song analysis video here with me today. If you don't know the format, we're going to talk about the song. We're going to dig through it piece by piece. We'll go back, we'll sing the whole thing. And also, at the end, if there is any questions, I do an Ask Me Anything portion as well. So, let's talk about this song a little bit. Again, it was written in 1943 for the Meet Me in St. Louis movie. Now, it is not weird in any way, shape, or form that musical theater writers were the ones who wrote A Beautiful Christmas Tune. For, in fact, a lot of the tunes that stick around about Christmas and the holidays in general, or winter, were written by musical theater writers. I made a whole video on this a couple of years ago. You can go back and watch that. But this one in particular has really stuck around, and it seems to do something to us, with us, for us. But there's something about it that might be a little bit too sad. And that's for a reason. Originally, when this tune was being written and put into Meet Me in St. Louis, it was pretty dark. Now, this song isn't the happiest. One could call it bittersweet. But the first version was relatively morbid. In fact, for an example here, one of the first lyric versions was, instead of "Let your heart be light, next year all our troubles will be out of sight," which is a lovely lyric. It's not what it originally was. It was, "It may be your last. Next year we may all be living in the past." Yikes. That's dark. As the story goes, Judy Garland said, "This is too dark. I'm not going to sing this. You need to rewrite the lyric." I don't know if that's true or not, but the lyric did get rewritten. Now, the version that Judy sings is different from the version that a lot of other people sing. For instance, the second time that it was recorded was by Frank Sinatra, and he went back to Hugh Martin. And I'll keep saying Hugh Martin from now on because, as it goes, Hugh may have written all of it, and Ralph Blane may have just gotten credit. I don't know what the real story is there, but that is something that he said later in his life about Ralph Blane. So Sinatra goes back to Hugh Martin and says, "Hey, I actually need this to be a little bit lighter even still." So, we have, in fact, I guess the quote from Sinatra was, "Do you think you could jolly that up for me?" Instead of "until then we have to muddle through somehow," which is a version you probably know from Judy or other people singing this song, instead it was ultimately changed for Sinatra to "hang a shining star upon the highest bough." So this song has been recorded countless times, and there are a lot of lyrics out there. All of them are indeed written by Hugh Martin. However, they've been requested, altered, changed, people kind of cherry-pick as they make new recordings over the years. So if you hear a lyric today where you're like, "That's not the lyric I know," that would be why. But let's dive into the song itself. In standard musical theater form, we are starting with a verse, and then we are doing an AABA 32-bar chorus. That's the song. That's all it is. We have gorgeous, lush chords in here. Jazz. Oh boy, does that set you up so nicely. But we don't go immediately into the tune. Now, one thing I want to point out here as I play through this song is this is the original published version of the song. So it may sound a little bit different. It's not the same key that Judy sang in. I don't think Sinatra even sang in this key. This one is written in C major. Though, we will talk about that as we go through today. Why it feels so light and hopeful at the same time so dark and sad. But we get this lovely little verse here after that pretty and haunting descending pattern, which takes us to our tonic. Christmas future is far away, Christmas past is past, Christmas present is here today, bringing a joy that will last. And that's our verse. Short, sweet, to the point, pretty much two lines that mirror each other. But there's one crucial thing in the music that is going to set us up for the remainder of the song, and I want to get there in a moment. Before I do, though, we already have this idea of the future and the past and the sadness, right? He may have cut those previous lyrics, but we're still getting a sense of the sadness of the past. Christmas future is far away, sad. Christmas past, sad. Christmas present is here today, bringing joy that will last. And isn't that a joyful and hopeful thing? Yes, indeed. However, here's the beautiful thing he does in the music. We have, like I said, we are in C major here. And we're actually on a C major chord to begin with. It's open the third, so it doesn't feel so complete and whole and steady. But the sad lines take place in the C major modality. Christmas future is here to stay. Christmas past is past. Major music with sad sounds. Then we get this lilt, this almost longing lilt of ya-da-da-da, pulling us back to where we think we're gonna land, back on our tonic. It's not where we go. All we do here is add an A into the bass. Now, for you composers and music theory nerds out there, that does mean, yes, we have moved to our relative minor. So, C major's relative minor is A minor. That is where we're going to start the lines that have the positive lyric with A minor, with that dark or sad or feeling. Christmas present is here today, bringing a joy. Oh, sorry, joy that will. We get back to a major feel there, setting us up on our lovely five dominant into the C major beginning of the chorus. But this feeling of mixed gravity, are we being pulled to C major? Are we being pulled to A minor? Is part of what makes this song feel dark yet hopeful. For those of you who are not music theory nerds, when I talk about the center of gravity and a key center, basically, what happens on sheet music is that C major and A minor look the same. Neither have sharps or flats in the key signature. So until you really look at the piece and see where home is, you can't tell what key a song is in. It's usually pretty quick and easy to scan through and find out. In this song, however, we are going to treat the A minor like it is home base a couple of times as well. And that was our first example right there in the verse. Now, obviously, most people don't record the verse, so I don't know, you may have never heard that before. But let's go on and start talking about the rest of the song. Now, I'm going to sing what's on my paper, and then we're going to talk about what the Judy lyric was from the original. So we have, oh, and this was printed originally in 1944. That can't be right. 1971. So the original sheet music publication was 1971. Just so we know what we're working with here. We have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight. do another A section. So that's our first A. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight. The original Judy Garland lyric sung in the movie was, "Have yourself a merry little Christmas, let your heart be light. Next year, all our troubles will be out of sight." So, from now on is perpetual. Next year is kind of just living in survival mode, right? So there's something, again, darker about that original lyric. All right, let's talk about what this song is doing. We have our lovely C major feel with a walking bass line. A nice second, right? Nice two chord, D minor 7. Going back to R5 7. Ah, standard, easy, lovely, right? And then we're just going to repeat that chord structure. Let your heart be light. It sounds a little wistful to do a two minor chord there. This is what we're circling around, right? It's not saying we're super happy. It's also not saying we're sad, but maybe we'll get there. This is the first time we get there. So we have our from now on our. Every other time so far, we've stayed in C major the whole first measure. Now we're going to go to that minor feeling, to a relative, to A minor. From now on, right there. It's an A minor 7. On R. And then we're going to go back to our 2 minor. Troubles will be out. That's our G again, our 5 of sight. And we're not going to go back to our tonic immediately. Wait, so it's basically the same progression, but we added in that A minor. So it got a little bit darker. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight. Instead of going here, we go to an E major 7. So, at this point, again, we feel like we're in C major. The E is the third in this key center, and normally the third would be minor. We've lifted it to major, and we've added a 7. Now, you might be thinking to yourself, wait, but Michael, if we're taking something that was minor and we're taking it and making it major instead, doesn't that mean we've gone to a happier place? Potentially. There are two things about that could change how it feels from being a happier feeling. The first one is, what came before it? Does it feel natural to go to that major chord? And the second one is, what comes after it, right? It's really all about the context. So because we're in major, minor, minor, and this doesn't feel like we're gonna head to the next chord, right? It's a surprise. It's a little bit jarring. Not in a bad way, but it definitely doesn't say like, oh, that's a happy place we're headed. And then we go to our A minor again. Or excuse me, not minor this time. We go to an A major. And that feels like, oh, that's happy. And then we get a D major and a G major. Oh my gosh, Michael, what are you complaining about? It's all so happy. Yes, but then we have to look at the inner lines. Because here's what happens. Remember that sad descending pattern from the verse? Christmas past is past. And how it feels wistful? We've taken that wistful feeling and we've stretched it out even further over these major chords. Almost all of which have sevens in them. That means it doesn't quite feel so easy and comfortable and stable and major. There's a something there that is longing, right? So that whole line, from now on our troubles will be out of sight. Chromatic descension. Oof. Kind of pulls at the heartstrings a little bit. Just that. Imagine a clarinet playing that. Beautiful. Second A section. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. about that for a hot sec. First and foremost, most of the music is the same. Very little changes until we get to Troubles Will Be Miles Away. Instead of Troubles Will Be Out of Sight, we get Troubles Will Be Miles. Oh, that's a surprise, because again, we're going to that E major 7. What? But that's earlier than we did last time. You're correct. And we're doing it from our D minor, so we're going from here to here, which automatically pulls our ear to. Anyone with me? Probably not. A minor. And that's exactly where we head. So remember what I said before about kind of tossing us back and forth between that center of gravity feeling like C major and A minor? This is the first time we very blatantly, in the course of the song, the main part of the song, pull our ear toward the A minor. We do go back to C major for a moment. We're going to crunch it up before we hit our B section. But that feeling, again, it feels dark. Troubles will be miles away. Oof. Oof. Gorgeous, but dark. Then we are going to go back to C major with a 7. We're going to flat our 2. Which I guess is really a flat 9 at this point. But we're gonna raise our 5th from here to here. That's not a comfy chord! So, again, the crunch, the jazz of it all really makes a difference. And then we're gonna head into our B section here. What was Judy's lyric? I think the only thing that changed was instead of from now on our troubles will be miles away, it's next year all our troubles will be miles away. So again, having that like that cap of time, we're only thinking 1 year in the future because that's as far as we can think when we're in survival mode. Sadness. B section. We have something completely different. Here we are as in olden days. Happy golden days. Perfect lead-in back to our final A. Beautiful. Beautiful. You know, I never said who I was and what we're doing. My apologies. Hi, if you're new to the channel, I'm Michael Ratty, aka Musical Theater Writer Guy. I am the founder of the Musical Theater Writing Collective, an online, well, online and hybrid community of musical theater writers from across the world where you can go and learn and gather and pretty much get all the information that you need in order to write your things, develop them, get them produced, and also make this a career. So, that's a little bit about me. My apologies for not saying that earlier. Here we are, as in olden days. Judy's lyric is different. Once again, as in olden days, happy golden days of yore, faithful friends who are near to us will be dear to us once more. Uh-huh. So, we reverse it here. Faithful friends who are dear to us gather near to us once more. Judy's lyric is sadder, right? Once again, only one time, instead of here we are, which is very open. Happy golden days of yore, yester. Faithful friends who are near to us will be dear to us. So what happened that they're not dear to you right now, but they will be, right? There's so much like, oh gosh, are you okay? Judy? Well, But faithful friends who are dear to us gather near to us is a bit more hopeful. It's a bit more in the spirit of gathering, giving warmth, light, all that sort of thing. So these small changes to the lyric really do make a difference. But here we are. Starts on an F major chord. We're just adding a G into it and it sounds so lovely. The other thing we're doing is we're adding a 7, a major 7 on top. All the 7s I've mentioned before now have been minor 7s, like a standard 7. This is a major 7. Why is that important? That lift feels like maybe something better's on the way. Maybe, just maybe. Here we are. then we immediately make it a minor chord instead. But we keep this note. Now that feels crunchy instead of hopeful. Or as in olden days. That's our tonic, we're C major. But we did it over the third again, just like we started the song. So it doesn't feel quite like home. Olden days. Descending pattern. It's a diminished chord, but it actually kind of feels nice here. Happy golden days. That's our 2, minor 2-7 again. Days of yore. Instead of doing our normal 7 chord for coming to your, that's what we've been doing in the verse so far, right? Every time we've had that D minor 7, we've gone to a G7. Instead, this time we're going to a G augmented chord instead. And there's something about that that feels a little bit funky in the right way. Golden days of... Ooh, kind of cozy. Your... And for the first time, we're going to C major with a major 7. And that's where the vocal is, too. The vocal's been on all these major 7s. So the vocal is kind of crunching with what the piano's doing. Oh, God, it's beautiful. Days of yore. Then, faithful friends. Oh goodness, what is this chord? It's an A minor chord, but it's a funky version of it because it's an A minor 6 chord, and we're putting it over our 6. 6 is in the bass. Faithful friends. Oh gosh. How far away are we getting from the feeling of home at this point? Which might be on purpose. Right, we're kind of lost in the darkness of this time of year in this song. Faithful friends who are... And again, here we have a B major 7. And then we're going to even make that a B augmented with 7. Like, woof, we are pulling the ear. Who are dear to us? That's the first time we get an actual E minor chord in the whole song. Dear to us. We're going to that augmented G again. Gather near to us. Oh my gosh, finally a standard G major chord. Thank you, Hugh Martin. Quick A minor 7. D major 7. Oh, once more. Us back to our G major 7. Ah! It's beautifully constructed. Right? We kind of have this feeling of, okay, we're starting on our 4 chord. That's fine. That's nice. Right? We can do that. But then we immediately screw with it. Mess with it. Sorry, YouTube. We add a G and we add a major 7. And then from there, we just get further and further away from our tonic feel and placement. Even the A minor, we're not really headed toward A minor, even though we tuck it in here, we tuck the C major in here. But when we circle back around, we get that G7, we know exactly where we're headed, back to our A section. That's a beautifully constructed AABA. All right, now that I've chatted your ear off about the B, let's do the B again. I'm gonna sing Judy's lyrics. Once again, as in olden days, happy golden days. Of your, was it? Faithful friends who are near to us will be dear to us once more. Always with that bell tone G, isn't that so pretty? It's probably actually a bell in the real orchestration. Anyway, final A section, here we go. Through the years, we all will be together, if the fates allow. Hang a shining star upon the highest bough. Extension. Chords in a second. Oh, let's just do it. Now, don't want to leave you hanging too much on it. All right, but let's break that down a bit. Music stays the same. Oh, lyric first. Instead of through the years, again, very open, we have someday soon. Someday soon we all will be together, if the fates allow. Until then, we'll have to muddle through somehow. If you've never heard that lyric before, or your brain just kind of skipped over it because it knows the other one, I understand. But it's such a beautiful line, especially with a gross word like muddle, right? Until then, we'll have to muddle through somehow. So have yourself a Merry Little Christmas. Wow. Dark. Dark, dark, dark. This lady is not on her way to joy at the moment. She's hoping for it, but she's not on the way there. And that's reflected very beautifully in the music here. So, all the music stays the same until every other time we've gone down, or this time we're gonna go higher. Ah, beautiful construction. A shining star upon the highest bough. Star is the highest note of the song. Again, though, that original lyric was, until then we'll have to muddle through somehow. So the highest line, the highest phrase of the song was on that lyric, that gorgeous lyric. Construction of the chords. We have that C to A minor again, to the D minor. Star upon the, and we're gonna go back to our E major, but we're gonna just add a flat 9 to it. Highest bow, to land on that crunchy A minor again. See, that's the second time now we've pulled the ear, the center of gravity, back to A minor. Ah! Major minor, major minor, major minor. This is why it feels so bittersweet and so good. C major 7 chord, like we did before, with a flat 9. And then we augment. So, slightly more crunch, right? We get the A minor feeling to our C major 7. That's standard, at a flat 9. Augment the 5. He never lets us rest. We never get that relief. But now we're going to go back to the thing that we started our B section with, which, by the way, is a beautiful trick for an extension. If you're writing an AABA course and you're not sure how you want the extension to wrap back around, use the first chord from your B section, which, if you remember, was an F major chord with a G with a major 7 on it. And the vocal was on the major 7. It's precisely where we go. And F. And that feels right at this point. F yourself. Minor again, A minor. A merry little. Merry. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. For the first time in the entire song, we are singing the word merry over a minor chord. And it's the last time we sing it. Merry little Christmas. And we again get that G with the flat 9 instead of the 7 chord. Makes you want to weep. Then we go to our C major with a little bit of an ending C, F, C. But the last chord's not a standard C chord. We can't leave it perfectly major. We add in that major 7. No. It's just so good. This is a gorgeously constructed song. Music and lyric both. No matter which lyric you're looking at, whether you're looking at the more open-ended version that got published or Judy's lyric that is a bit darker, I think at the end of the day, this tossing back and forth between major and minor in a really well-constructed jazz song, jazz tune, with these ideas of the positive, the hope, and the negative, what is actual reality at this time of year for a lot of people, it gets you in the feels. And it does it really well and succinctly. Let's go back, let's do the whole tune straight through and see how we feel about it. All right, we start actually right where we ended. Christmas past is past. Christmas present is here today, bringing a joy that will last. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. From now on, our troubles will be miles away. Here we are, as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful friends who are dear to us, gather near to us once more. Through the years we all will be together, if the fates allow. Hang a shining star
Beautiful tune. Gorgeously constructed. What more is there to say? So, hope that this song analysis of Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas was interesting to you. Gave you some ideas on why this song sticks around. The things that capture our spirits the most as human beings are the songs that hit us where the emotions lie. Joy. Sadness. What they mean to one another. In our human interactions. There's something about what this song is and does that does it perfectly. Merry Christmas to you, Steamship. Thank you for being here. Thank you for watching. As always, I will stick around for a couple of minutes in case anyone has any questions. It's an Ask Me Anything sort of portion. It can be about the song. It can be about anything else. But while we're standing here, I just want to remind you that the musical theater canon has some of, I think, the most gorgeously constructed pieces of song, of songwriting that capture the spirits of things that we try not to say aloud. And I know that a lot of people don't feel the best, the happiest, the most joyous at this time of year. And I think that this song sticks around so much because of the fact that it captures the sadness that is automatically in a celebratory holiday. And a celebratory time of year. It's not always joyous for everyone. So the happiness and the sadness both being there, I think is part of what makes it absolutely gorgeous. You prefer the Christina Aguilera version? That's fair. Everyone has their own favorite version. My favorite is Judy's. What I didn't mention before, this is just for fun. Where am I? Yeah, 2, 4, 6. Great. This is actually Judy's key down here. And this is so much warmer. I think she sang the verse. I don't remember in the movie. But Judy's warmth down here. Have yourself.
pulling the voice down that low automatically brings a sadness to it. And I think that's part of why her version is my favorite. But anyway, doesn't seem like you have any questions today, and that's totally cool. So my friends, the next live stream won't be until 2024. So I wish you all a very happy holidays, a very safe and peaceful new year, and I will see you all again soon. All right, everyone. Have a great one. Bye.